Good morning.
Good morning.
So happy to see everybody here, and hello to those watching us on Facebook. So today we have Reverend Doug Watts who will be doing our service, and our guest musicians are Julie Hickox, and she has brought a wonderful violinist with her today.
Donna Stewart.
I already got her name right here. I asked you for. I knew I could ask you, but no, I ought to get her name, Donna Stewart. And thank you, Donna, for coming this morning. And our house musician, Rick Milan, on piano. So happy that everybody's here today. If you would please turn your phones to silent or off, that would be terrific. We'd appreciate it. So let us stand and sing our first song, Life is for Living.
Start out, why don't we turn to the one beside us and say, good morning, I see the Christ in you. Let's do that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I see the Christ in you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
And you too.
Thank you.
Good morning. I see the Christ in you.
I see the Christ in you.
Yeah, you got plenty of room.
Ready to go. I don't really have a Bible verse, but I do have just a little story that it probably will relate that way. I remember years ago seeing my grandmother in her basement. Oh, this is a number of years ago. She had a washing machine. Now, it was probably one of those built in like the 50s, where it was the agitator, it was a barrel, and then they had a wringer on the top. Oh, it sure made doing your clothes so much easier. Many were electric, but some had the hand. You had to do the wringing by hand. And I remember that very vividly. And then also I remember maybe being 10 or 12 and I was driving, well, when my parents were driving, and I remember them talking about a new thing, and it was in Roanoke at the time, frozen vegetables, yeah, like frozen peas and beans. And they were saying, you know, how wonderful this will be, how much time saving this is going to be. And I also remember that the person that was doing this in Roanoke made an absolute fortune. All he was doing really is wholesaling, but he made a fortune doing that. Well, that brings me to this point. Sometimes things come too easy for us. In our grandparents' day, they had to work pretty hard to get the chores done, and most of the time they stayed pretty happy. And it's remarkable to me how today, with all the free time we have for entertainment and so forth, that we can find ourselves so unhappy. A Stanford psychiatrist came up, she believes she came up with the idea that our brains are constantly trying to keep us in balance. That if we chase happiness too much or chase easy things too much, our brain quits producing dopamine, quits producing our pleasure. So this isn't a new idea. This isn't a new idea at all. Matter of fact, some 2,000 years ago, Jesus had a pretty similar idea. He said, be of service to others if you really want to have happiness. Let's turn now to our statement of being. Will you recite with me? It's only TV screen. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am the individualized expression of God, and am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. Julie, would you play for us? Now is the time in our service. If you're watching on Facebook and you're not familiar with us, this is the time we call it our healing meditation. It's the time we take a moment out of the day and we go into that secret place, you know, that closet that was talked about. We try to release, relax, let go. You know, you came through these doors. I wish I could look at each heart. I think I could see in some hearts joy, thanksgiving, peace. Maybe another heart might be troubled. Another heart sad. Whatever you brought in today, whatever your state is right now, I invite you just to release it, to let it go. Put it in the Father's hands. I turn all my concerns over to God. I allow God's love to be my love. God's peace to be my peace. God's wisdom to be my wisdom. God's wellness to be my wellness. I know that all life is blessed, for it is God in expression. We are directed to turn it over to God. Release it. Breathe. Beloved, these next 90 seconds, I'll invite you to go deeper in your thoughts and deeper in your thinking, to have your own conversation with God, beginning now. You felt the love of God and the peace of God and the wellness of God. I give you peace. Do not let your heart be troubled or afraid. I give you peace. Amen. We get to go. This beautiful intention of the Lord's Prayer. Please recite with me. Our Father who is everywhere, your name is sacred, your kingdom is come, your will is throughout the earth, even as it is throughout the universe. You give us our needful bread from day to day, and you forgive us our offenses, even as we forgive our offenders. And you let us not enter into materialism, but you separate us from error, because yours are the kingdom, the power, the song and praise, from all ages, throughout all ages, sealed in faith, trust, and truth. Amen. That's just beautiful. Well, how do we start? How do we start? You know, I wish I could say I started, I was trying to think about the Synoptic Gospels, you know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and comparing them to John, and when John is talking about Jesus in Judea, I wish that's really where I started this from, but I didn't. I was riding, and I had Wendy sitting here in the passenger side, and we were riding, and this is maybe 2-3 weeks ago, we came to a three-way stop sign. And there was a guy that pulled up on my right, and but he beat me there, so I sort of motioned him to go on. Well, the person on my left, they didn't really beat me. I think I got there first, but I don't know. They looked like they wanted to go quicker, so I motioned them to go on. Well, Wendy, she said, "Doug, I wish you wouldn't have done that." What? Well, you see, you confuse people. You had the right of way, and indeed I did, but you let them go on. You've got to obey the traffic laws. Sometimes I have a problem with that. So that brought up my subject for today's message, stopping. And one of the greatest stops I've ever heard of was in the Bible, where the Egyptians Israelites were leaving Egypt after 430 years of slavery, and the Egyptians were going after them, and they came to the Red Sea and they stopped. Let me read just a little bit here. I'm going to read Psalms 106, just a little. We'll set the stage, so to speak. When our ancestors were in Egypt, they gave no thought to your miracles. They did not remember your many kindnesses. And they rebelled by the sea, the Red Sea. Yet he saved them for his name's sake, to make his mighty power known. He rebuked the Red Sea and it dried up. He led them through the depths as through a desert. He saved them from the hand of the foe, from the hand of the enemy. He redeemed them. The waters covered their adversaries. Not one of them survived. You know, the parting of the Red Sea is one of the greatest things in the Jewish history that's still celebrated today. Do you know where the Red Sea is? We've got Egypt here. We've got the Red Sea running right here. We got Saudi Arabia here, Jordan here, and Israel right up here at the top. So we've got this snake of the Red Sea. Now, I want to tell you something about the Red Sea. It's not like the River Jordan or the Sea of Galilee, which is really a lake. The Red Sea is really something. It's 221 miles across. Have an average depth of 1,660 feet. The greatest depth is 9,700 some feet deep. But 40% of it is only 364 feet deep. And one of the most shallow places in the Red Sea, this is probably where they think they went across, it's only 164 feet deep. Well, that's a little deeper than a swimming pool, isn't it? But God is committed to keeping you and me free. We have freedom of choice. God's nature never changes. His love never fails. God will find a single soldier to free a nation, a boy with a lunch, kill a Goliath. God will calm a sea or calm a wind. You know, I read about the people of Israel going through the Red Sea, and they could see the wall of water, but you know what they also heard was that click, clack of the Pharaoh's armies chasing them. But God told his children, "You got to go." After 400 years of generational substitute, you got to go. And I was also reading something about this in the Bible. It says, There were 600,000 men leaving Egypt. Well, that didn't count the women and children. There might have been like 1.2 million people leaving. Some places I heard there was 2 million people leaving. And it just changes the whole idea I had about the Red Sea. I almost said it like it parted, and they sort of went single file through the Red Sea. But if you've got 1.2 million people carrying all their oxen and all their treasure, and the old and the affirmed and the young, it's got to be a pretty wide swath. I don't know how wide. I was trying to think. Maybe it was maybe from here to that food line way across the street, or maybe it's a little further. I mean, a lot of people have to go through that. A lot of people. Again, I was talking to Wendy this week, and we were talking about the Bible. And she correctly said, you know, the Bible is a book of history. And I said, yes, it is. It is a book of theology. And I started reading the definition of the Bible, and it said, well, it's a book of livable teachings, relatable teachings. And it's also the science of Christ-like living. Bam, I thought, you know, that is exactly what divine science is. If you look at divine science, if you look at the definition of divine science, it says it's a practical and reasonable way to live a Christ-centered life. We've just evolved, and we know that God is omnipresent. We've evolved to that. Also, I was thinking about the Red Sea. And your parents, or their parents, and the parents before them, and well, the parents before them, and the them before them, and before them, and before them. You see, there was 400 years of before thems. And even today, we have generational poverty cycles. And even today, we have generational cycles of substance abuse, and we have generational cycles of anger. We're not that much different, are we? We see the Egyptians chasing us as something more powerful than they really are. But in front of us, all we can see is the Red Sea. It's that insurmountable thing that I think we all come to sometimes, that problem we don't really know how to handle. And sometimes you say, you know, I thought I was ready for that responsibility, for that new job. I thought I was ready for that. But I didn't know it came with all those problems. Well, I thought I was ready for retirement. But boy, does it change things. Well, I thought I was going to go gracefully old. No one told me that getting old is not for sissies. We've all stood in front of that Red Sea, haven't we? We've all stood in front of that Red Sea, that insurmountable problem. I thought I had changed and I'm ready for that new relationship, but I brought that baggage with me. And I want to point something out to you here. The Red Sea's here. Watch what the people do. They're not that much different than we are. Watch what they do. I'm going to read something to you in a minute, but watch what they do first. They blame and try to shift responsibility. Does it sound familiar? Let me read Exodus to you for just a moment. As the Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to this desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? It would have been better to first serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. Let me tell you something. Nowhere did they ever say that to Moses. Now that they see that insurmountable Red Sea in front of them, they try to shift the blame and shift the responsibility, just like we do many times. That brings me to a little story. I remember, I don't know how old I was, maybe the first year of college. I worked part-time for Pizza Hut. I think I made, I hate to say, 75 cents an hour, going wages, part-time. Well, the manager liked me because I was dependable. I'd show up on Saturday morning and make the dough and knead the dough and had that big dough machine. I could get it going, and he liked leaving me there for the lunch crowd because I could run the cash register. And he liked leaving me there for the evening because he didn't have to come. I could, again, run the cash register. And he had a buddy, and his buddy sort of fancied himself as a upcoming tennis pro. Well, I never really trusted his buddy that much. And here again, you see, I was doing the cash register. That was one of my responsibilities. But he also allowed his buddy on occasion to open and close the cash register, maybe make change for someone. Well, came at the end of a shift. I don't know, it was a Saturday morning or something. I went to my work, 75 cents an hour. And the boss said, "Doug, I balanced the books last night. You were $20 short. I'm going to take it out of your pay the next 2-3 weeks, maybe. I'm only earning 75 cents an hour, and I knew I hadn't done it. It was his buddy that had made change and probably taken that 20 and put it in his pocket." The manager tried to shift responsibility, tried to me take the blame. Well, he didn't get his 20. I quit. The job wasn't that important at that time anyway. That was not going to be my career. Let me read a verse 15 here. What we do sometimes after we try to shift responsibility. "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on.'" You know, that Red Sea, that insurmountable problem in front of you, you've got to move on. You've got to move on. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death," you've got to walk on. Now, I want you to visualize this, if you would, just with me for just a moment. We've got the Red Sea in front of us. We've got the waves up here. It's 164 feet deep. So those walls of water are quite high. Sometimes these things we run across in life, these problems we have that we are confronted with, it can be handled this way. This is, I guess, a teaching moment for me and for everyone. Attention is the key to life. Whatever you really give your attention to, you become. Whatever you really concentrate upon will come into your life. That wall of water, the problem is so big, I don't know how to handle it. But I do know where to put my attention to. I do know where to put my attention to. I allow God's love to be my love. I allow God's peace to be my peace. I allow God's wisdom to be my wisdom. I allow God's wellness to be my wellness. Wherever I am, God is. We go within with me. Father, I've run across that Red Sea. I've come to it. And I'm sure everyone here has had that season in their life. But Father, I think I know from now on that I need to take my attention and put it on you. Your love, your peace, your wisdom, your wellness for my life and for their lives and our lives. Amen. Julie, would you play for us?
Thank you.
we started the service off today with acknowledging the Christ within each of us. And now we say the blessing of the gifts. And one of the gifts we have is just being nice to each other, having a smile to each other, supporting each other, loving each other. As well as we have some of our other blessings, you know, our time, talent, and of course our monies. Would you please recite with me the blessing of the gifts? Today, I acknowledge God omnipresent as the source of all good, as the source of my good. With this acknowledgement, I accept God's will, which is abundance in every aspect of my life. I release all thoughts of lack and limitation, and I am open and receptive to the increased flow of abundance to me right now. I joyfully accept the gifts of life and give freely of the special gift that I am. Through me, God omnipresent blesses and multiplies this gift for all. Thank you, dear God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Julie and Donna, for beautiful music. Thank you, thank you. And thank you, Donna, for coming with Julie and...
I got lucky.
Yeah. We all did, so...
Some of y'all got lucky. It's something different.
Yeah. We're always flexible here, so good. Thank you for being here. The flowers today are sponsored by me for a celebration of 4th of July, so that is this week. Some people are already celebrating. I worked at my house last night, we're already going off, and it's like, not happy. My dog's not happy. Anyhow, there are people traveling or whatever. So everybody, please enjoy the holiday, but be careful and safe. We have a board meeting next Sunday at 9 o'clock before church. So and we will be welcoming our new board member, Amy Jo. And so 9 o'clock, and as Amy Jo said, be here or be square, so be here. on July the 14th, right after the service or during the service, we will have Miss Nancy being ordained as minister. So congratulations on that. And other than that, still talking to Bill and William about a concert. I don't know when we're going to have that concert. They're going to do a concert for us to raise money to pay for the carpet. So we're still working on that. They're busy and I'm busy, and so we're trying to get the schedule worked out so we can have one. Maybe early fall, which might be better than in the summer. But anyhow, we're still working on that to have that done. Other than that, it's extremely hot, the humid, and so please check on your neighbors, or as people always call me up and say, I'm checking on the elder. And I said, well, you got the wrong numbers. please be careful with all this heat. I know that it is extremely hot for a lot of older people or younger people. Everybody is having a hard time with this, so please be careful with all that. And as I always give my spiel, please, please, please be kind to people. Watch your words, because everybody in this room is going through something. And they might not always tell you, but they are going through something. So please be aware of that and pray for everybody here. And you got anything, Marita? Okay. Have you started a new book yet? I've never heard anything, so.
Yes. Here, here you go. What we're doing actually, speaking of that, so they can hear you. What we're doing these days is the third book of the life and teachings of the masters of the Far East. And it is all divine science. It has these great masters saying these things, but all it is divine science, and we are really enjoying it.
Great. Okay, Miss Nancy, it's all yours.
No, sing away.
No.
I didn't laugh. I know. Silly. Go away.
Go away, right?
Yeah, go away.
Done. Are we ready? We're going to close today. Can you put that prayer of protection? What I want to do is I'm going to include the U.S. in this. We're just going to do a 30-second prayer for the country, the world, some of the political actions you might agree with or not agree with. But let's just take 30 seconds for that, and then we're going to do our prayer of protection. Please go within just for 30 seconds. As we say the prayer of protection, would everyone stand as we say this? Please. Recite with me. The light of God surrounds you. The love of God enfolds you. The power of God protects you. The presence of God watches over you. The mind of God guides you. The power of God abides in you. The strength of God renews you wherever you are. God is, and all is well. And now we'll have our last song of the day.
Well, you'll have to wait until I...
We're going to have to wait?
Thank you. Thank you. God bless.